Here is a quick look at our agenda. We're forced to talk about cable and electrical properties. I'm going to try to do that makes in a fashion that makes sense to telephone people. I'm not an electrical engineer. We're going to talk about how to set up to make accurate a measurement sequence. We'll talk about pass fails. We'll demo this stuff on the ONX. So if you've got your ONX with you, please turn it on. And when we get to the appropriate time, you can follow along with me. Towards the end of the session, I'll introduce something I call the kicker. And then we'll end with things to remember, frequently asked questions. That sentence that you see at the top of the slide, I've been in the phone business now over 30 years, and I must have heard that statement at least 10,000 times, right? Everywhere you go, people say we really have bad cable here, right? Well, I found out that bad cable is relative, and here's what I mean by that. In my travels across North America and outside of North America, I have yet to come across a cross-connect box that looks like that. Now, I just start to giggle every time I look at that. Look at how calm that guy is. He's using some handset, it looks like, attached to God knows what. He's smoking a cigarette, just as calm as a cucumber. I think that's in Beirut, Lebanon, by the way. Here's another one that I like for noon technicians. You know, they start complaining, well, you know, it's a mess out there, and I don't really, how would you like to climb that pole? Find your drop or your terminal. So messes and bad cable are relative things. So I'll go from that right to an eye bleeder. I told you that forced to talk about some electrical properties here. We just are. I would be remiss if I didn't talk about some electrical properties. Now, electricity and its properties turn a lot of people off, and for good reason, I think. Electricity is invisible, and it can kill you. Those two things right there make a lot of people shy away from it. But as long as we're working for the phone company, as long as the phone company has copper cable, we are forced to deal with two prominent electrical characteristics, that being resistance and capacitance. Now, capacitance is two conductors separated by insulation. Well, heck, that sounds like a cable pair to me, right? The cable pair is a long, skinny capacitor, and it's manufactured to an exacting amount of capacitance per unit of distance. The same thing applies to resistance, materials opposition to flow of electrical current, measured in ohms. Both of these dominant characteristics manufactured to very exacting standards for unit of distance. So really, all that means is for a test set company, I know the standards, so I measured the standards and I give you a result. It kind of makes things easy. Now, to me, all this electrical mumbo-jumbo seemed backwards. A lot of it seemed backwards. The big wire has less resistance than the small wire. 26-gauge cable is smaller in diameter than 19. See what I mean? There's a lot of backwards stuff. But we're going to revisit these two properties as we go through the presentation, and hopefully we'll reintroduce them to you in a way that makes a little bit more sense. Now, this is targeted more for our new technicians, but at the end of the day, what are we really trying to accomplish? And again, I'm talking about copper cable here, obviously. No matter if it's a 50,000-foot loop going out in the country or a 3,000-foot bonded VDSL loop, the goal is the same. We're trying to get two copper wires between point A and point B, right? Well, what might happen along the way? Well, the first thing I would think of is, what if the wires were broke? I mean, if I didn't know anything about telco and you asked me that question, I'd say, well, what if the darn wire's broken, right? Well, of course, the telco slang term for that is open. But as we all know, telco slang is subjective as all get out, isn't it? Because that word open means a lot of different things. Both wires broken? Only one wire broken. How about a wire that's partially broken? Is there a poor connector on one side versus the other? All of those things kind of fall under this broad subjective category called opens. What else can go wrong? Well, on dial tone lines, there's a certain amount of battery present. Battery is there to do two things. It signals the central office, and it also powers the telephone set. Now, we check battery in telco in a very peculiar fashion. And what I mean by that is we don't pull out our voltmeter to see whether or not we've got 52 volts or dial tone, do we? We pull out our butt set to see if we got dial tone. So we do it counterintuitively. We measure for battery when we expect no battery to be there. Right? And if we see battery when no battery should be there, the telco slang term for that is cross battery. In other words, I'm in contact with another customer's line. Now, the thing to remember for you new folks, when you have cross battery, you automatically have more than one case of trouble, right? You got the trouble that you're dispatched on. You also got the poor customer that your customer's line's touching. What else might happen? Well, what if the wires are touching each other between point A and point B? They're wrapped in insulation for a reason, right? I don't want them to come together or to complete a circuit until they're either at A or B. Along the way, no, we can't have them touching. And if they are touching, we refer to that as a short. The same way with any connection to ground, we don't want them not only touching each other, we don't want the wires to come in contact with the ground or something that is attached to the ground. Right? Now, for the brand new telco guys that I train, I have them bring in a hand coil of Cat 5. And as silly as that may sound, I found that it's really helpful because at the end of the day, whether it's 25 foot of Cat 5 or 50,000 foot of F2, the goal is the same. Okay, where do you want to test and isolate? Again, pointed more at the new technician. That's a big deal to me when I started. I mean, we didn't have strict M&Ps on where you were supposed to go, and the whole thing just seemed bewildering to me, right? I knew that cable pair left the central office and magically showed up at some address along the way. And I was totally intimidated on the path between the two points. Right? Well, this becomes a pretty simple game of isolation to start with. I think most of you would agree. Now, I'm going to only talk about the cable to the field side of the crossbox. Now, if you don't have buried F1 cable, in other words, direct buried cable to a crossbox, well, then, yeah, this applies the minute you walk out the central office door. But you have an F2 section there, and it's typically from the crossbox to a serving terminal. You have a drop from the terminal into the house, and then finally you have Cat 5 or interior wire going to a modem or a residential gateway. You have three logical test sections. Where do you want to isolate? Right? Now, you all develop some really keen and efficient methods of dividing and conquering this stuff. The only thing I like to show with this slide is sometimes different work groups are responsible for different sections that I just brought up here. So when you got three of something, you got a problem right off the bat, don't you? Because you can't isolate that quickly, right? When you got three as opposed to two. Setting up for accurate measurements, kind of an important one here. If possible, know what's on the far end of the circuit. Huh? If you're unsure what the far end of the circuit is attached to, that could give you or lead you to false conclusions about the line. Now, the same goes with the cable pair should have service removed. Not only should you know what's going on the far end of the line, but ideally you want the service removed, right? You want it dead. You want to be testing an inanimate object. Two copper wires separated by insulation. Now, I know that's not always possible. And again, for the newer folks on the line, the reason you kind of want to be sure of what's going on, the typical residential gateway, for example, it doesn't meter as any type of resistive fault, but it adds approximately 2,000 feet of length due to the capacitive components inside of the residential gateway. So having things draped across the far end when you're trying to test it's a good way to get yourself fooled. You want to be thinking about an inanimate object, two copper wires separated by insulation. sectionalized logically. I really can't say any more than that. We've got some fairly large companies signed up for this WebEx, and each company has their own M&P. So for me to suggest that you do something would not be good. I'm just pointing out the logical sections here and how you might want to isolate and conquer. Now I'm going to suggest a logical order of tests to make on a cable pair. This is the same order I was given as a young guy. Now I wasn't given the training behind that, but I was told the same order. The first was check the line for AC and DC voltage. All right. So that was AC for safety and DC for cross battery. So the first thing we would do is remove service, right? And then that counterintuitive approach. We're measuring for battery when no battery is expected. The second in the order, and I almost look at these as a batting order in baseball, if that makes sense. The second in the second hitter is resistance. I was taught to look for shorts and grounds. The two wires touching each other is either wire touching earth. If there were no shorts and ground, I would check it for opens or length. Now, in my day, we kicked things with an analog meter. Didn't have an open meter, so I'm really dating myself here. But when you attached an analog meter set to read resistance on one side of the cable pair with one test lead and then the other side to ground, the needle would kick or deflect. Now, the amount that it deflected was in directly a result of how long the wire was. So the things you were looking here for is that each one deflected the same, you know, both conductors. And it was up to you to build up that mental database of how far that deflection was and the distance associated with it. And I'll never forget the old cables guy that showed me. He said, "You see how that needle's deflecting?" I said, "Yeah." He said, "However far it goes to the right," he said, "that's as long as that conductor is." He said, "You do that for about a year, you get pretty good." And he walked away. That was my training. Huh? The last one is balance. He's the cleanup hitter. He gets everything else. So along about the time we get these last two, we'll be shifting up a couple gears. So hopefully we'll wake you up if you're sleeping. Okay, voltage measurements, AC and DC. You measure AC voltage primarily for safety. Now there are pieces of information to solve the puzzle out of every one of these measurements. So I made myself a promise years ago that I would never talk about anything unless it had a practical application, because I find that people don't have a lot of bandwidth in their day for useless information, right? I mean, you can tell me about something that I don't need to do? It's not a smart thing. Follow company safety practice. Most all you guys have tremendous safety practices. Just follow them. Just follow them. They're for a reason. I know you get beat to death about that. Some AC voltage tip to ground and ring to ground is normal. So in your cross box and you're looking to the field and you measure AC volts, it's very normal to see AC voltage from tip to ground and ring to ground. It's normal. Now, I've had telephone guys tell me over the years, "Well, you shouldn't have any AC on your line." Well, all you've told me, son, is that you've never gotten out of the city, right? Anybody that's worked in the country knows that you will have AC voltage on the line. Now, a practical application besides safety for AC voltage is that AC voltage gets on our cable pairs one of two ways. The first is a very short-lived violent event where the power company stuff comes in contact with our stuff. Our stuff is usually vaporized in the process. The second is through a process called magnetic induction. Now, when the power company induces a voltage, this is done through the air, by the way, when they induce the voltage on our cable pair, they have no way of discriminating against the tip wire versus the ring wire. In other words, they put the same amount on both wires. So if you and I were looking at a cable pair that we were fixing to use for an install or trouble, and we saw a tip to ground of 2 volts, ring to ground of 4 volts, that would be a bad thing. Well, I would say to you, "Well, I don't know what the hell it is, but that pair is in trouble," just by the fact that it didn't have the same amount of AC voltage on each side. And that's what that bullet says. You measure DC volts when no DC volts are expected. So what I'll do here is just kind of pop out of the PowerPoint and bring up my ONX tester. And just give me 1 second here. All righty, I am showing my ONX. Now it might be a little bit of lag, but if anyone is not seeing it, please raise your hand. So the ONX itself, a brand new flagship product that we've come out with. The copper testing is behind the copper drawer. I kind of like the look of the opening menu here as a tool chest, right? And you pull open the drawer. That sounds kind of corny. But you pull open the copper drawer and there's a bunch of tests in there. Well, I'm going to select number one, multimeter, because everything that we're going to talk about today is contained in the multimeter. Now, the modern test sets that you and I use are computers. They have a variety of different processors in them, and Viavi uses a Linux operating system or Linux platform. So if you're a computer whiz or buff, that probably means something to you. So they act like computers. Now, when I select multimeter, I load this whole row of icons into the test set's memory. Now, the reason I do that is if it's resonant in memory, I can pop between these tests really, really quickly, right? As opposed to unloading one and loading the next one. These are all present, ready to go. We were talking about AC and DC volts. That's the first in the lineup, right? I've got two ways to view results. I can view them in a snapshot fashion in the bottom left-hand corner. There is a icon labeled snapshot and continuous. Now that's a toggle. What I mean by that is the active one appears like it's brought to the fore and the inactive one's kind of shoved in the background. You can see how there's a little bit difference there in size visually. So when you hit that, either touch the screen or touch the button, that will toggle you back and forth between snapshot and continuous. Okay. Now in snapshot mode, I made 6 measurements here for voltage, AC and DC, and I did them pretty darn fast. I'll do that again. I hit refresh. That's pretty quick because there's some lag time associated with the internet. Now, on the surface, that kind of looks cool, but I don't know. My wife says I'm a pessimist. I don't think I am. I think I'm a phone guy. Every time I see something that looks cool, I automatically start looking for what's uncool. Now, the what's uncool is this is a picture. A snapshot. So if I hook up to the dial tone in my office right here, it's going to say 0 volts DC until I refresh the snapshot. Well, most phone people I know are not cool with that. They like to see things continuously. So I hit the toggle for continuous. Now in continuous mode, it's a much more granular look at what's going on. I can only show you one lead combination at a time and one voltage type at a time, right? So I went from this big 6 measurement snapshot, both voltages, to right down as low as I can go. One lead combination, one voltage type. Obviously, to switch between the types over here in the bottom right-hand corner, there is the same sort of visual toggle for AC and DC volts. So I hit that button. AC is brought to the fore. DC is shoved in the background. See, we got the AC volts up here. Obviously, if I touch or use my down arrow, I'll go from tip to ring to tip to ground. So a very easy tester to maneuver, I think. The touchscreen adding a lot of pizzazz to it. Now, I keep track of the minimum values and the maximum values I see. It's probably not all that exciting on a voltage test, but this format will duplicate itself for other tests. We'll talk about that as we go along. We'll switch back to DC volts, and I started to say in the beginning of the presentation that phone people measure voltage in a peculiar way, right? Most voltage measurements are done in accordance to a specification, right? You're checking something on your car where you know you should have 14.3 volts, right? So you're slapping the voltmeter on there and you're measuring it. Now, I had a colleague, he was much smarter in other technologies, but he needed a lot of help in copper test. And he used to say, Well, a voltmeter is a voltmeter. What's a big deal? What do you got to talk about there? Well, when we measure for voltage, we expect no voltage to be present. When voltage is present, we don't know it, but we're looking at what engineers call a voltage divider, right? All that means is if you worked on cross battery, you know that sometimes you have amounts of battery all over the place, right? Sometimes you have hard crosses, 50 some volts. Sometimes you have medium crosses, 20 some volts. And then sometimes you have really light crosses, 4 volts. I mean, that's the way I rationalized it when I worked outside until somebody gave me a new meter. That turned my world upside down because everything I'd looked at on my old meter did not jive with this new meter. I was completely lost. The part that was never explained to me is this part up here that I got my mouse under. The termination impedance of the meter. That's a very important thing when you're measuring a voltage divider. Now, that is found under the options tab, and there's two choices there. Excuse me. 100 k ohm, k meaning 1,000, or 1 mega ohm, m meaning 1,000,000. So one of these terminations at 100,000 ohms, the others at 1,000,000 ohms. Right? Significant difference between the two numbers. Now, all you really need to remember is if you see a difference between meters when it comes to voltage, think about the termination impedance of the meter. Right? Think about the termination impedance. We have this setting on another one of our test sets, but we have it hidden. And it is amazing to me if I go in and do a live training class on the other test set, and we get to this portion right here, half the room will have the 100 k ohm selected. The other half will have the 1 mega ohm selected. It's uncanny how often that happens. Well, if I'm looking at something with 1 mega ohm term and you're looking at it with 100 k ohm term, there is a possibility for us to see huge differences in cross battery on the same cable pair. As much as, say, your meter showing 4 volts and my meter showing 26 volts. Same cable pair, right? Difference in termination, okay? Now, when we do our more in-depth classes, we usually draw this out in a diagram. I'm not gonna take the time to do that. Suffice to say, pick one of these and stick with it, right? And if you come into a situation where you're baffled because two meters are showing you different voltages on the same cable pair, think of this. This is 99.9% probability the reason you're seeing the difference. Now, some questions may come to mind. Is one of them better than the other? No, they're just different. Another question might be, why did you put two in there? Just to confuse everyone? No. Some phone companies want their lines tested at 100K. Others want a higher impedance measurement made for their trouble. One final thing about it, maybe this will help it resonate in your mind. It did me. When you're crossed with a dial tone line, you know exactly how much battery is there, right? 52 volts. How come you don't see 52 on every case of trouble? Well, I always thought it was depending on how hard the cross battery problem was, right? Were they physically smashed together? Was it through some water? Was it just through a damp connection? That's only half the story. The other half is the termination impedance. If my termination impedance is high enough, you would see 52 volts on every cross. Everyone. Huh? A little freaky, but true. The reference to ultra far end device control, ultra fed control, that's a little far end device. We're not going to be talking about that today. Fast refresh and standard refresh, I can't tell the difference. If you can, good for you. I can't. So the meter is very fast either way to me. So pick one of those. If you're really lost, pick the 100 k ohm. That's probably a nice safe one for you to go with. All right. So that is AC and DC voltage measurements. Let me go back to my presentation here. A little clumsy slipping back and forth, but run through this stuff. So pretty basic stuff so far, right? Shorts and grounds and practical Ohm's law. Now, Ohm's law, here we go, right? He's going to start talking about electric. Now, Ohm's law is pretty basic stuff. It's been around forever, right? It's got three parts: voltage, current, and resistance. The big deal is, if you know two of those three parts, you can very accurately calculate the third. Now, this same colleague of mine, we were in a presentation together for some reason, I don't know why. And like I said, his background is not in the copper test all that much, but he sort of fancies himself as knowing more than he does. Shouldn't say that, but it's true. And a technician on the other end of the phone said, "How does an ohmmeter work?" Well, I knew he was going to lock up. Well, he locked right up. He said, "Jeff, would you like to take that one?" I said, "Sure." An ohmmeter is nothing more than a DC battery. I tell new technicians, if you've run a flashlight, you've run an ohmmeter minus the switch and the bulb. Right? The ohmmeter puts out a known amount of voltage on the line, and then it measures any current that it sees from a fault. It's got two of the three parts of Ohm's law now, doesn't it? So it calculates resistance. Huh? Now, hell, I knew how to run an ohmmeter. The first week I was at the phone company, I damn sure didn't know how they work. No one told me what I just told you. Well, I kind of figure that out the hard way. All right. So this is the old, we don't want the two wires touching one another. We want either wire touching the ground. Well, as I said, we were going to talk about the electrical properties, but we're going to do them in a different fashion. So instead of banging you over the head with Ohm's law and all this other crazy stuff, we're going to use some terminology from the past, the back in the day terminology. I love this stuff. It's said that there has been no great idea or no new idea. It's just regurgitation of old stuff over and over again. And the older I get, the more I believe that. Now, in the old Bell system, they taught on something called contact faults. Now, I think that's just brilliant. Because the Bell system is like the military, right? They taught you how to do stuff, not why you were doing it. So they were very, very efficient at some things. But some of the ideas they had were beautiful. Contact faults is a great way to describe resistive faults, right? I don't want my tip wire in contact with my ring wire between point A and point B. I don't want either one in contact with ground or something attached to ground. Now, it's really funny when I do these new technician training classes, I'll tell the folks in the room, I'll say, take your two index fingers and just as lightly as humanly possible, touch your two index fingers together. Now, of course, you've always got some big alpha male in the room that won't do it, right? But most guys and gals, well, the gals always do. Most of the guys do it. And they don't know that when you're staring at your two index fingers, trying to touch them together as lightly as possible, your eyes cross. So I'm standing there looking at them, laughing, right? Inside. Now I tell them, I said, you could certainly say that your two index fingers are in contact with one another, right? But that contact is not that solid. Now contrast your two index fingers touching one another to balling up your two fists, putting one fist against the other and pushing just as hard as you can. Now, your two fists are certainly in contact with one another, right? Would you say the contact between your fists and your fingertips, quite a bit different? Yeah. Your two fists together would be representative of a low resistance fault, where your two index fingers touching would be representative of a high resistance fault. So all the ohmmeter is trying to do is tell you, hey, you got your two fingertips touching, or hey, buddy, you got two fists smashed together. Right? And it does that with Ohm's law and a number. So let's look at it on the ONX. So the next in line, as a young guy told me the other day, oh, you're talking about that upside down horseshoe test. Yes, I am. Resistance. Notice we have the same snapshot continuous toggle in the bottom left-hand corner. Under our options tab, we'll just look here. We got some things that we'll talk about tomorrow under here. Yeah, most of those things we'll talk about tomorrow. Oh, by the way, I should have said this earlier. I will have things on my meter that you see today that you won't have. I've got the latest and greatest version of software. Don't worry. This test set is having stuff added to it constantly, working on it constantly. It's a big deal in our company. So you will be notified probably through sales. You can always find out through our tech center of what the latest version of software for your particular company is. And I would encourage you to try to keep up with that if you can, because we're adding stuff all the time. We're fixing bugs all the time. So the same sort of thing, continuous or snapshot. Most phone people like continuous. One lead combination. I got a minimum and a maximum value. I keep track of that over time. Now, here's a spot where that's really handy. And what even for you more experienced techs, ask yourself, if you've used an analog meter, how many times would you have liked to have looked at the meter and then at the same time wiggled something around? Aerial drop. Old piece of IW going through a green encrusted hole on the side of the house. Man, I like to wiggle that sucker around, watch my meter at the same time, but my arms aren't 30 feet long. Well, here you can, right? The minimum and maximum will capture it for you. Now, as I do these sessions, it's always kind of a giggle. I'll ask the techs, what does that number have to be in your company before it qualifies as a good circuit? Now, I get answers all over the place, from extremely high values. Recognize that number is 999 million ohms. The equivalent of my little finger-touching story that I just told you. Say you're in Montana and you're pointing towards the state of Michigan, and I'm in Michigan pointing towards Montana. That's how much contact there is between our two fingers at 999 million ohms. I mean, it's perfect, right? It's perfect. Now, if you don't have a standard, I would suggest one for you. And that standard would be, you might be shocked by it, greater than 3.5 M. Greater than 3.5 M. Now you might be saying, whoa, that's a hell of a lot lower than 999 M. Yes, it is. It's a very practical starting point. Now, I've ran into lately here a whole bunch of areas, I got to be honest, that I got 30, 40 guys from the same company on the other end of the phone asking what their number is. Nobody's got a number for me. 3.5 M or higher. Now, if you take me to task on that, you're going to find times when you have a case of trouble that's less than 3.5 M, and you're going to say, hey, that guy from Michigan was just pulling our leg. This is working fine. It's got less than 3.5 M. I will guarantee you, if you stick to that new value for your number, you're going to run into an area where you have the same value where it just worked fine, where it's noisier and all get out. So 3.5 M or greater gives you a little cushion there. It's used in 95% of North America. Logical question would be, how much, why would you extend your range that far? Well, personally, fellas or folks, I think it's marketing. My little analog meter didn't go past 10 M. Dynatel was the first to take it to greater than 100. Dynatel again was the first to take it to greater than 999. When the needle doesn't move on the sidekick, that's greater than 20. Well, not that you folks care, but from our side of the business, you can't afford to have the meter with the smaller number. So all the prominent meter manufacturers are all setting at greater than 999 megohm. That's a fly wing on the moon. There is a practical application for that much range. Perhaps we'll talk about it either tomorrow or Friday. Switch lead combinations, just touch it, right? Common theme. Now, I'm showing voltage on mine. You are probably not on yours. That's something that we've added. I don't want to take a lot of time talking about it here because it's something you don't have. Now, in the bottom right-hand corner, we have a labeled button there. It says leakage. Go ahead and press that button. When you press that button, a black-bordered yellow triangle will appear with a lightning bolt in it. That's an indication that you've increased the voltage coming out of the meter. Remember I said an ohmmeter is nothing more than a DC battery. In my non-leakage mode, where we started from, approximately 20 volts is coming out of that ohmmeter. When you hit the leakage button, that gets boosted to approximately 120 volts of DC coming out of the ohmmeter. Now, let me point something out. The 120 volts is a current limited supply. Current is what kills us. Current does the damage. So it's not like the 120 volts coming out of your wall socket at home. We are current limited. I can't hurt you. I can't hurt electronic equipment. Now, I always tell the same sort of story because I don't think I was the only guy that ever did this. But if you walk up to your buddy in the summertime and it's hot and he's kneeling down on the wet grass and you touch him on the back of his earlobe with this meter when the leakage is on, he is sure as hell going to know he's been touched, but it won't stop his heart. The thought being is that the higher applied battery will look harder for a short or a ground or a contact fault by applying more pressure. Now he's starting to sound like he's going into electricity stuff again. Yeah, I am. But I promised I was going to do it in a more common folk way to understand it, right? I'm not an electrical engineer. I used to, when I was a little bit more prideful, say things like, well, I wish I had Google when I was growing up. I don't say that anymore. I'm old. I don't care what people think. But when you type in basic electricity in Google, it's phenomenal, right? 0.7 seconds, you get 300,000 hits. If you go to some of those sites, they're brilliantly done. And a lot of the times when you go to a basic electricity site, electricity is compared to water systems. And they'll say like the water pump is like voltage. It's got the ability to do work or to apply pressure. The water flowing in the water systems, that's kind of like current. And then the pipes themselves, kind of like the resistors. They got a great big fire hose, you got a garden hose. Follow me? So another way to rationalize this in your head. Now, if you get the electricity stuff, you probably think I'm a nut job, but I didn't. So I always think of any and every way possible to explain it differently so people don't have to go what I went through. All right, so leakage is going to pop up the applied battery a little bit. Can't hurt you, can't hurt electronic equipment. I'm going to suggest a number, 3.5 M or greater. If any result comes back with the letter K next to it, it's in trouble. I don't care what anybody says, it's in trouble. And if any number comes back with no letter next to it, it's really in trouble. That's your two fists slammed together as hard as you can. Right? Now that's the way I had to remember it. Because if you were like me and you still got an analog meter hidden under the front seat of your truck, and they give you this digital meter, chances are you're not using it for shorts and grounds. Right? Because you're used to seeing that needle swing, and by golly, that needle means something to you. So making this transition is a difficult one. I will agree with you. I found out that once I got the first set of numbers in my head, the second and third and fourth and fifth set of numbers were that much easier to swallow. But of course, you're going to do what you're going to do. Last thing on the ohm meter that you can't see. Now, if you have used an analog meter before and you're in the 25 to 30 year experience range, I will guarantee you've run across a case of trouble that showed grounded. But when you hit the reversing switch on your meter, the ground disappeared. Now, I'm a child of the late 60s, early 70s. I remember the first time I saw one of those. I thought I was hallucinating. I had a solid ground. I hit the reversing switch on my meter. The ground disappeared. Well, what I was looking at, I didn't realize it until years afterwards, was a diode fault. Now, those are called rectified faults in Europe. Europe has a clear way of communicating something because that's exactly what they are. They mimic a diode. Now, a diode's a little piece of electronic gear that only allows DC current in one polarity to flow through it. If you reverse the polarity, the diode will block it. And that's exactly what was happening to my ohm meter. Of course, I didn't know anything about diodes. I didn't know anything about polarity. I didn't know anything about anything, right? All I knew is I had a ground. I hit the switch, the ground was gone. Now, there are tons of things in the customer's equipment, D-slams, that have diodes in. From a trouble standpoint, the thing that mimics a diode is green corrosion. Right? Green corrosion. They actually use that substance to make the first diodes out of. So they're naturally occurring diodes. Now you might be wondering, why in the heck is he telling this? Well, the ONX in the background, you can't see it, but is constantly hitting its reversing switch over and over again. Just like you do with a Sidekick or maybe an old Simpson meter that you have, right? You hit that reversing switch with your thumb because the next thing you want to do is kick it, right? Well, the ONX is doing that for you. We don't want you to miss a diode fault. All right. So that's our ohm meter. I'll pop back to the presentation here. All righty. It's a little clumsy. I need to figure out a smooth way to do this. So it's Ohm's law. That's how the meters calculate resistance. Right? An easy way to think about them is contact faults, fingertips versus fists smashed together. I can apply a higher applied voltage. Oh, by the way, one thought on that voltage. I'm glad I reminded myself. If you sat through this class today and I told you this stuff about 120 volts and your buddy didn't, he didn't get to sit through it because he had to go shoot trouble. And then you tell him, hey, that guy from Michigan said 120 volts comes out of this meter. And your buddy said, no, it's what he said. So he go gets his meter. You turn it on leakage. He puts his voltmeter across there. He's not going to see anywhere near 120. That has to do with that pesky thing I talked about earlier, right? The voltage divider, where you're looking at another one when you do that. And the only way you'd see that 120 volts is if you got a lab or a bench meter from an electronics lab. Super high impedance termination. Then you would see the 120 volts coming out of our test set. Now, I only tell you that because, believe it or not, I've had guys and gals do exactly what I just told you and not see 120 and think that their meter was broken. So. All right. Opens, capacitance. We said in the beginning, tip and ring are held at a constant capacitance per unit of distance. Now, that number is 0.083 microfarads per mile. Is that something I need to remember? Of course not. Of course not. I just want you to know the standard exists. The interesting thing about the standard is that it is universal across cable gauges. So 26 gauge is 0.083 and 19 gauge is 0.083. Now, I remember when we were given, I don't know if you guys and gals ever went through the tailgate sessions, remember? Well, like I said, every good idea is already been thought of. We had them in the 80s. And the guy that came and gave us the open ones, he had to have a military background because he just he stood there and he, you know, came first manufacturer, you know, 0.083 microfarads, 26 and 19. Well, as in it, I didn't get it, right? And I thought, well, I'm not going to ask any questions. I'd rather walk away and be thought the fool than open my mouth and remove all doubt, right? I knew that there was one heck of a difference between 26-gauge cable and 19-gauge cable. And this guy is telling me it's got the same value across it per unit of distance. I did not get it. Right? Well, what he didn't tell me that I told you two or three slides in is what the definition of a capacitor is. It's two conductors separated by insulation. It's a cable pair, right? Well, if the conductor sizes are going to change radically, like they do between 26 and 19, the only thing you have left to fool with is the insulation thickness. So that's what cable manufacturers do. Huh? To keep that tip and ring number the same per unit of distance. What does that mean to me as a repair person? If you got a nice, clean, double-sided open, that tip and ring number is pretty damn accurate. However, if only one side's open, the tip and ring number really doesn't mean anything. Huh? Now you're interested in a tip-to-ground length or a ring-to-ground length, depending on which one of the two wires are broken, right? That's how the lion's share of open circuits are. They're not nice, clean, double-sided opens. We wish, eh? Well, when you have one wire broken, there is no single standard. Huh? The capacitor definition is the broken wire and the cable shield that just happens to be tied to ground. Those are your two conductors, so anything between the two is considered the insulation. Well, what's between them? Air core cable? Icky pick cable? Water-filled cable? All of those things are going to affect the amount of capacitance per unit of distance. So, long story short, if you're doing a single-sided open, you want the cable fill type to be correct, don't you? You also want to remember that open meters measure all the cable connected to them, including bridge tap. Huh? All right, let's look at that on the ONX. So next in the row, there's the little picture of the broken wire. Got the minimum and maximum, continuous snapshot, same sort of thing as before. Now I'm showing you other things down here. We're either gonna have to do a real short session, maybe a white paper on it or something. I can't go down this rabbit hole because I wouldn't get through what we want to or need to talk about in this first session. I remind you what the current setting is, cable type up here towards the upper right-hand corner of the screen. To switch cable type, it's found under options, right? Select cable. And there would be your different cable types. Your biggest difference will be seen between air core and jelly. That's the biggest difference. The bottom line here, this isn't rocket science, right? You all know that if you're, most of you, right? Know that if you're going to get an accurate reading to open one side, that you darn sure better have the cable type selected right. Now, a lot of guys fret about this needlessly, you know? Well, Jeff, it's not that simple. We don't have all air core cable. We got combination. This ain't rocket science. If you think you got half and half, split the difference, right? Take a shot on air, take a shot on jelly, split the difference. You got the heavyweight champion of the world to back you up in the TDR. Huh? So, not rocket science. Just don't be shooting a single-sided open and air core cable, have my machine set to jelly, and come back and tell me my ONX is no good. As we'll have to talk about all this stuff again. All right, touch the lead combination that I'm interested in. Now, if my 25, 30-year-old techs are still awake, if they're not, you guys next to them, shake them, wake them up. We're going to start to talk about something that's a little bit more interesting. Right? Promised you this. We use the term ground very loosely in telco. What I mean by that is look at my open meter there. I got a tip to ring distance, right? And then I got a tip to ground and a ring to ground. And I just told you what that really meant. It meant from the ring conductor to the cable shield that just happens to be tied to ground. Let me say that again. From the tip conductor to the cable shield that just happens to be tied to ground. Why is he saying it that way? Because it's a very, very important concept to get in your head. So think in cap time. We use the word or label ground very loosely. I think it's from electricians, to tell you the truth. In their world, ground is ground, the world around. You probably heard that saying. Not in telco. Not in telco. A great way to illustrate this is, say, you ran out to your truck, got a box of Cat 5 wire, brand new box of Cat 5 wire. You know exactly how long that box is because it says so right on the outside, right? You open that box up, you strip it back, you get blue white, pair one, you hook your ONX tip and ring leads up to blue white. Now you need a ground. Right? Well, your boss just last couple of years ago passed out those little safety things, those things that you plug in the electrical outlet. Gives you safe access to the third prong, right? The third prong of the electrical outlet is the multi-neutral ground from the power system. That's the best ground around. Doesn't get any better than that. Hook your green lead there. Now go up on that box of Cat 5 and measure length, tip and ring. You will find that we're pretty darn accurate, even though we're made to measure Cat 3, we're pretty acceptably accurate on Cat 5. Right? Now touch either tip to ground or ring to ground, I don't care which one, and tell me how accurate I am. I will be so far off, it'll be laughable. It'll look more like, give it a time, it'd be more like that. I'll be so far off, it'd be laughable, even though I'm attached to the best ground around. Pull that green lead out of the little safety device that connects to the multi-neutral ground and connect it to another pair in the box of Cat 5, say pair 2, orange-white. Now look at your tip-to-ground and ring-to-ground distances. They will be much more accurate. Because what the opens test needs is a parallel reference. Not just ground, it needs a parallel reference. The shield is a parallel reference, right? Just happens to be tied to ground. That concept begins to introduce probably the most important thing, in my opinion, that I'll talk to you today about, and that will be longitudinal balance here in just a second. So when we say to ground, we say it a little loose. Really what we're talking about is cable shield that just happens to be tied to ground. Now, since the open test returns a distance or a value, it is important from time to time to compensate, we call it, this test. And it's really a different word for calibrate, but I'm not technically supposed to use that. If you find the button in the bottom right-hand corner, there's not a lot of buttons on the ONX, but I'm talking below the arrow buttons, right? Dead center, you got that picture of the house. I'm talking the button right to the right of that. I don't know what the hell that looks like. Set of stairs or something. We call it the system tray. If you press that button, it will take you to a spot where you can compensate opens. See that? First little icon, the bottom left. If you touch that, it will tell you to open all test leads. All that means is don't hook to anything and don't let the test leads touch one another. And press the big fat button that says compensate. You just told the meter, hey, I'm not connected to anything. Zero out any capacitance you see. Huh? Now, you shouldn't have an issue with that, these brand new meters. But as you go through heat cycles and stuff, eventually it'll come back and you'll start showing some footage there. Now, the other, I guess I I open up Pandora's box, I should at least give you an explanation of it. Right next to compensate opens, there is something called opens method. Stick to three terminal. Your default is three terminal, stick to three terminal. There's an application for a two terminal measurement, but we're getting some pretty high end stuff. So that is there. If you wonder what it was and wonder which one to use, use three terminal. Now, as I run opens, you may notice that if I have a contact fall, for example, I'm going to touch, I'm measuring tip to ground, I'm going to touch my ground lead to my tip lead. Now, a message pops up there at the bottom of the screen, severe line impairment, measurement will have error. I guess so. It went from, 1,700 feet to greater than 100,000. So one of the things I'm doing with my open meter is sniffing in the background to see if there's anything out there that will screw up my ability to measure length. So for your more experienced guys, you know you can't kick a line if it's dead grounded, can you? It's not going to kick. Well, open meter is the same way. You put a hard enough fault on the open meter, it ain't going to read opens. Right? So we're sniffing in the background. So if you see that message pop up, chances are you're in trouble as far as using the open meter. Right? There's something else on there that's really screwing you up. All righty, back to the presentation. Let me see where I'm at. All right, constant per unit of distance. The big thing is when we do one-sided opens, we need a parallel reference. That is, the shield just happens to be tied to ground. Right? And open meters measure all the cable connected to them, including bridge tab. The kicker, time for a little bit more thought. If I have no cross battery, no shorts or grounds, no opens, I have a good pair, right? Well, no, nothing could be further from the truth. All that you have proven is you have continuity between two points. That's all you've proven. Now, that hit me like a pail of cold water when I was outside because I thought, well, what are you talking about? Pairs either cross, shorted, grounded, or open, right? What is there? That's what I fix. Nothing could be further from the truth. Every service we put on copper cable is a form of AC waveform. That includes our voice all the way up through VDSL signals. Right? It's an AC waveform. When I speak into a transmitter of the phone, now I'm going to really date myself. The transmitter had carbons in them. Modern ones don't, of course. But the vibrating column of air coming out of my mouth varied the resistance of the carbons in the transmitter that superimposed an AC waveform on the cable pair. That AC waveform got turned back into vibrating columns of air by the receiver in the telephone set, the person I'm talking with. But along the way, it was an AC waveform. My voice is AC, your voice is AC. Mm-hmm. Now, think about that for a minute. A lot of guys say, what are you talking about? We're digital. The hell you are. You're digital on either end, but when it's on the copper cable pair, you're nothing but AC tone, man. People say, well, have you ever shot trouble on this? Have you ever shot trouble? I don't care. I don't care what it is. It's AC. It's all going to act the same way. Now, when it gets to the other end, that might turn into something magical I've never seen before. So be it. But when it's on the cable pair, I'm not a bit intimidated because it's AC. So if we weren't going to talk on cable pairs, if we weren't going to do IPDSL, if we weren't going to do high cap HDSL T1, if we weren't going to do VDSL bonded, if we weren't going to do any of those things, do you suppose we'd have very many customers? Well, of course not. I guess maybe on the cellular side. Well, all of those things from my voice to bonded VDSL is AC waveform. AC waveform. So you can say that we're in the AC transport business. If we weren't going to transport the signal, chances are, well, I know one thing, I wouldn't be here. I don't know about y'all. So if there's no cross, no shorts or grounds, no opens, what has that told me about my ability to transport AC? It really hasn't told me anything. I haven't done anything to measure that cable pair's ability to transport the very signal that I am employed by, right? The AC signal. Another interesting thing about AC signals is just like open meters, they go anywhere there's cable for them to go, don't they? Yeah, you know that. Then DSL, it goes down bridge taps, right? So it's an AC signal. It's going to go anywhere there's cable for it to go. So introducing the kicker, the longitudinal balance. Now we're gonna do it one way. We'll do it verbally, and then if anybody does happen to have a butt set in there, I would encourage you to also listen, and I'll show you how to do that in just a second. We'll go back to the meter. So I kind of skipped over milliamp current flow. I guess we can come back to that and kind of wrap up on it. But test I'm talking about is a teeter-totter test there to the right, longitudinal balance. A longitudinal balance is the single best test to make on a cable pair, bar none. The reason I say that is it tests all electrical properties at once, one time, and returns a very simple numeric value back to you. Now, when I saw anything with a dB on the end of it when I was outside, it's not what I do. I don't do the dB thing. You know, that's special service, that's central office guys, not me. For a long time, I didn't understand this concept. I was lucky enough to meet a guy close to 30 years ago that, believe it or not, came up with this concept. He was one of the original Belcore team that came up with it. Longitudinal balance. Single best test I know to make on a cable pair, bar none. Now, we had a pretty large, diverse group from different phone companies. Maybe you've heard of the Sidekick. Maybe you have a Sidekick. The equivalent of longitudinal balance on the Sidekick is the stress test. Now, if you have a Sidekick, because I train in a lot of areas where there are Sidekicks, and I always have fun there. Because when I go into a garage and we get to this part of the training, I'll say there's no such thing as stress. Right? Well, the young guys, they start to bow right up. You know, they're ready to hassle. They're ready to throw down, right? The old guys, they just sit there and smile. I said, hey, yeah, I'm pulling your chain. Stress and longitudinal balance, the same thing. I got buddies that still work at Greenlee Temple, where the Sidekick is made. I asked one of them once. I said, why in the world did you call it stress? Why didn't you call it longitudinal balance? You know, that's what you're doing. He said, well, we thought that the technicians wouldn't understand the word longitudinal. Well, everybody started laughing, me included. But in the back of my mind, I was thinking, damn, he's right. I don't know what that means. So I went home that night and I looked it up. Essentially, it means along the length of. So balance along the length of the pair. Too many words put on the screen. Longitudinal balance. Now, Sidekick took this test, morphed it around, showed you a different component of this same test, and called it stress. Now they set the whole industry, whoever's got a Sidekick, they set the whole industry on its ear. Because if you go and you ask a Sidekick user, do you like the stress test? He'll say, oh, darn right I do. It's a great test. I don't know about this longitudinal balance thing, but I like my stress test. It's the same darn thing. Number one issue though, the higher the number, the better the pair when it comes to longitudinal balance. It's completely backwards from the Sidekick, right? Same exact test. The standard used across much of North America, obviously the higher the number, the better. But the cutoff is 60. So most phone companies say we would prefer balance be greater than 60. Meaning a 70 is better, right? 80 is better yet. 90 you rarely ever see in the field, and you're only going to see greater than 100 in extremely well-balanced pieces of test gear. I want you to think of this number as a noise rejection number. A noise rejection number. The higher that value is, the more noise my cable pair will reject. Kind of an important concept. So let's talk about how it works. I need to bring up paint here. Now, you know, people think about longitudinal balance, stress, and all this, and, you know, all sidekick invent. Well, I said, no, they didn't. Neither did we, neither did Dynatel. The people that invented this test were Bell Corp, a scientific arm of Bell. Right? And this test is utter brilliance in its simplicity, in that it generates its own artificial noise. It creates noise. That's the signal that it uses. 1,000 cycle tone, milliwatt tone, right? The old guys know exactly what I'm talking about. Milliwatt tone's in every central office, isn't it? They think so much of that tone, they give it its own personal phone number. Yeah. Widely used tone in telco. Now, I teach a lot of the young guys, as I said earlier, and I'll tell you what, they're sharper than a tack when it comes to the data stuff. You know, you get them into IPOE and the Ethernet, and they got, you know, they lose me in 10 seconds. But a lot of them had never been given any voice frequency training. You start talking about voice frequency, they look at you like a deer in the headlights. So just to be on the safe side, I'll give you a real quick AC class, probably the fastest one you've ever had in your life. At one time or another, we probably all saw a picture of these, one of these, right? It's a poorly drawn sine wave. The horizontal line in the middle is called the zero voltage line. So anything above that horizontal line is a plus voltage. Anything below it is a negative voltage. If I could mark off time and say between here and here was 1 second and I saw one oscillation, I would have a 1 hertz signal. Now, that's just the last name of the guy that dreamt this stuff up. These guys are all egomaniacs. They named everything after themselves. I think this guy's in Germany or something. So when I do longitudinal balance or stress, I am injecting a 1,000 cycle signal. So in 1 second, I'm seeing 1,000 oscillations. That's quite a bit. 1 second, isn't it? What would you say in that same second if I saw 196,000 oscillations? Man. Now you're really jacking the game up, right? That's a form of HDSL carrier. In that same second, if I saw 2.2 million oscillations, I could be looking at the top end of IPDSL ADSL 2+. And in that same second, if I saw 8 million oscillations, I'd be looking at the D2 band of VDSL. Now, I don't know about you all. I can't imagine 1,000 of anything in 1 second, let alone 8 million. So there's some magic there. But on the cable pair, it's still AC waveform. It's a tone. So back to the test. I'm creating artificial noise. I'm using this frequency. I know exactly how loud it is because I'm creating it. Longitudinal balance or stress is a two-step process. Step number one, I take that noise signal and I split it perfectly in half. I apply half of it, tip to ground, the other half, ring to ground. Split perfect in half. That's step one. Step two, the tester takes its ear and listens across tip and ring for the noise it knows is there. If the tip wire is electrically identical to the ring wire, the noise across them will be self-canceled. Tester puts its ear across there, it doesn't hear anything. If anything should happen to one wire that doesn't equally happen to the other, the self-canceling is no longer equal. Tester puts its ear across or begins to hear the noise. Now, engineers call splitting that signal and putting it to ground, they call that a common mode signal. There's something I didn't know what that meant for 15 years. Common mode. I'd sit in the meetings with the engineers, be common mode this and common mode that. Finally, I got to know one of them pretty well, and I said, you know, what's with this common mode he's talking about? He said, noise to ground. I said, you're kidding me. He said, no. He said, that's what we call it, common mode. Noise to ground, what does that mean to a telephone guy? It means exactly what it implies. We walk up to a network interface device, got dial tone on it. We clip our butt set from one side to ground. It roars, right? We clip from the other side to ground. It's roaring too. We clip across tip and ring. It's quiet. Where'd the noise go? I ask people that all the time. I said, where'd the noise go? And they'll look at me like, come on, Jeff. It's the ground, man. Everybody know ground make that noise. It's the ground making that noise on the pair. You disconnected from ground. Ground's noisy. No, it's not. The ground is passive. It's completely incapable of creating anything. The noise is already on the cable pair. The ground just allowed you to hear it. Huh? Told you to work for the phone company. I didn't tell you what I did. The last 7 or 8 years I was there, I worked in the noise and transmission side of things. Now, it was a great job. You got to work on power influence problems, right? No one knew what the hell you were doing, right? So you did have to fix something every so often. If you did, they would leave you alone for weeks at a time. So it was a great job. That's where I learned about noise on the cable pair. Right? Well, noise to ground is exactly what it implies. You hook your butt set from conductor to ground, chances are, if you're any distance at all on the cable pair, you're going to hear some sound. Well, we don't do our work from conductor to ground anymore, do we? Back in the day, we had ground start circuits. We relied on that. But now we don't do that. We got rid of those years ago. We do all of our work across tip and ring. Engineers call that differential signaling. Okay. So if my electrical engineer were presenting this portion of the class, he would say, well, folks, it's pretty straightforward. You don't want any common mode signal to appear differentially. And he would sit down with a big smile on his face. Well, then I'd have to get up and interpret, just like somebody had to interpret for me. And I'd say, what he really means is you don't want any noise to ground showing up across tip and ring. So that's what this test allows us to do, is to check sections or very short sections of our circuit to see how well they do with noise, to see how much self-canceling is there. The higher the number, the better. The higher the number, the more my cable pair will reject. There's an added benefit to that. The higher the number, the quieter my cable pair will be to those around it. I probably haven't given that one a lot of thought, have you? I never did. The reason I make such a big deal about this test is because this is how all noise works on copper, right? On copper. It's reference to ground. Not only the noise you and I can hear, but also the noise we cannot hear. DSL noise. It is humanly impossible for us to hear DSL signals. They are well beyond the range of human hearing. Now, I always chuckle when somebody said, what? I knew there was DSL on there because I could hear it. Well, you know, if he wants to believe he's listening to DSL, I'm going to let him believe it. But he's hearing some artifact. He's not hearing the DSL signal. You can't. It's impossible. Therefore, you can't hear the noise that interferes with DSL. So putting the line up to your ear does you absolutely no good. Well, the good thing is this test is just as valid for DSL noise as it is for the noise you and I can hear. Single best test I know to make on a cable pair, bar none. All right. I said 60 or greater. A lot of times companies will give you some gray area. They'll say, well, between 50 and 60, they'll call it marginal. If you got balance less than 50, I will put my $5 down next to your dime and we'll jump up in the truck and we'll find something broke. In fact, I used to be a lot worse than that, but I won't tell you what I used to say. We'll talk about an adaptation for this test. You're seeing it on your meter. I mean, it's pretty, there's not a lot to see, right? I mean, it gives you the number back, keeping track of the minimum and maximum. Right? If you do have a sidekick, you know you can make this measurement right across dial tone, can't you? The sidekick capacitively couples to the line. Yeah. What does that mean? That means I won't draw dial tone. I capacitively couple to the line as well. I won't draw dial tone. So just like your sidekick, if you have one, you can use it exactly the same way. You just got to remember the higher the number, the better the pair. I've got a little chart that compares the two numbers. If anybody wants that, please let David know and we'll get that to you. I'll show you an adaptation of this test, because I'm pretty sure that most of you folks probably using it probably agree with me it's a good test. I would encourage you to, if you haven't, listen to it. With it running, and you know it's running, the relays are clicking, right? Take your butt set and connect from the black lead coming out of the tester to the green lead. So butt set across black and green, listen to what comes out of the butt set. Loud ass annoying tone. Then listen across red and green, same loud, annoying tone. Then disconnect from green and go straight across red and black. Tell me what you hear. It'll be stone cold silent. Now the noise is still there. You just heard it. But it's being self-canceled. That second part, usually when I do live training class, I have the techs actually do that, because some people, it just really clicks, right? So. All right. I'll show you an adaptation of this test. If you don't get anything out of today, I would certainly encourage you to try this if you haven't already. If you have, boy, you can probably exit right now, because I don't have much else to tell you, at least today. I learned this about 28 years ago. Now, any of the stuff I talk about, somebody helped me learn. I'm not smart enough to come up with any of this on my own, believe me. I was reluctant to show what I'm about to show you, because when I'd show it to techs, they'd say, nah, I ain't doing that. It's too much running around. Huh? Well, I did a training class in Atlanta, Georgia. It's a couple of years ago, in a cable maintenance garage in Atlanta, Georgia. And so I thought, well, these guys are cable maintenance guys. I probably appreciate this. So I showed them what I'm about to show you. I had to go back to that garage like 2 years later. I can't even remember. The same manager was there, though. And boy, he remembered me. He said, hey, Jay, how you doing, man? I can't thank you enough for what you showed me. Well, I couldn't remember, right? I can't remember what I did yesterday, let alone 2 years ago. I said, what's that? He said, that thing with longitudinal balance, you know? I saw, oh, and it popped in my head. I said, how's that working out for you? He said, great. Now, I won't bore you with the stories and the numbers and all this stuff, but it's true. They drastically cut their repeat report rate by doing what I'm about to show you. So we'll actually use a case of trouble that I was on with one of his cable maintenance guys. This guy was sharp. He's probably at the top of his game, I'd say mid to late 40s. One of the sharpest guys I've been with. So I got crossbox on the left. I got customer on the right. And got cable pair. Cable pair is open at both ends. Remember, I want to know the state of the far end of the circuit. Now, I'm pretty sure your experienced guys will agree with me. If you're testing the cable pair, you want to know what's on the far end. Ideally, you want nothing on the far end. You want the far end just to be floating in the breeze, right? Not touching anything, not touching each other. Yeah, that's what we had. So we measure from the crossbox. This is a chronic. People have been there before. No shorts, no grounds, no battery cross resistance, 999s. Everything looked wonderful. We did longitudinal balance, 72 dB. 60 or higher, right? 72 dB is outstanding. Now, the reason I want you or would encourage you to listen to this test with your butt set is it's going to prove a couple of things to you. Number one, you hear it as a tone. The only reason you hear it as a tone is because your butt set is a speaker, right? You can just as easily take your AC voltmeter and put it across those test clips and see the voltage associated with this test. I don't want to confuse things, but it's an important principle, right? You hear it as a tone because you hooked a speaker to it. So when I'm at the crossbox, I'm looking to the customer, I am really applying an AC voltage to the line. And the result of that was 72 dB, which means excellent balance. Now, here's where the adaptation starts. Before I leave the crossbox, I short the cable pair, strip it, short it, and tie it to ground. They call that short strap to ground in the South. You got to love the South. I go to the far end of the circuit. The very next thing I do is another longitudinal balance test. If that circuit is sound, the second measurement should come very close to the first one. Here's what we saw. The second measurement, the bottom dropped right out of it. Excuse me. Thinking cap time. Huh? I had good longitudinal balance looking from the crossbox to the field. Far end of the circuit was open. I was essentially applying an AC voltage in the test set. Everything is wonderful. I then shorted the cable pair, tied it to ground, went to the other end, did the same thing, applied an AC voltage. What does AC voltage turn into when you give it a pat to ground? It turns into an AC current. Now I'm pumping current down those two wires. And there's something there that is telling me you have much more current flow in one wire than you do in the other. You've got an unbalance in current flow. All right. Well, talking about that current thing again, aren't we? Let's go back to our water analogy. Now, most of the time when we get to this stage, guys are saying, I know what it is, a high open. No, it's not a high open. High opens are easy. You got TDRs. If you can't fix high open, then you're not running your TDR. I don't mean that mean-spirited. We didn't have TDRs. High opens were a son of a gun. Huh? This is something much more devious than a high open. This is something called a series fault. A series fault means that somewhere between that crossbox and the customer and one of the many, many splices, you've got one scotch lock that's got 11 more ohms on the tip side than it does on the ring. That's a series fault. Now let's go back to our water. Like I said, I'm pumping water down the two garden hoses. What would the equivalent trouble be? I walk halfway down that hose and put my big fat toe on one of them hoses and not on the other. I'm going to affect the water flowing in the one hose that I'm standing on, aren't I? Same thing, same exact thing. Easier way to think about it. How do you find it? You find it with a TDR. What does it look like? It looks like the most innocent thing you've ever seen in your world. It's a little bump up. Looks like a half a splice. Very, very easily missed unless you know that's what you're looking for. Well, this test tells you exactly that. Hey, you've got a series fault. What did we do? Put the TDR on it. What did we find? Well, about 400 feet away, we both agreed it didn't look too great. We walked down there. Sure enough, there was a pedestal there. There was the customer's pair were cut through a terminal in that pedestal, beamed through a terminal in that pedestal. Now, for you that don't know what a bean is, it's a compression connector used in Bell. They put them in by the millions. And they had a life expectancy of about 25 years. But anyways, we cut that bean connection off, twisted the pair up, got it out of the terminal, right? Put scotch locks back on it, went back to the customer's house, did another longitudinal balance test. The 40 had gone to a 69. End of chronic, end of trouble. What's happening in the field today? Here's what I see happening in the field today. We're getting rid of dial tone. I don't think you say I'm wrong there. Most places are radically getting rid of dial tone. I am being incentivized, I don't even know if that's a word, by the local phone company here to where they want to jack up my dial tone rates and virtually give me a cell phone. Right? What do you suppose happens to the cable pair when you take dial tone off? They're high and dry, right? You're using VoIP now. Cable pairs start to go open. That's what happens. They don't go instantly high open. They go series fault first. Now, the thing about the 11-ohm difference that I'm illustrating here, if it stayed at 11 ohms, folks, you'd never know it was there. But it goes up and down with movement and temperature. The main weakness of DSL besides length is dynamic change. It hates anything to change. So if the 11 ohms stayed 11 ohms, VDSL, ADSL, it worked just fine. But it doesn't. It goes up and down with movement and temperature. Either way is just as bad. If it goes down, it's just as bad as it goes up, believe it or not. As soon as the DSL circuit sees dynamic change, what happens? CRC, code violations. Huh? That modem's only going to take so many code violations because it's going to drop like a stone, right? It's got to retrain. It's built into its little brain after so many CRCs. So you are hastening cable pairs going open by taking dial tone off them, because when the customer went off hook, you pulled dial tone, you drew current. That was a DC current, right? DC current back in the day was used as sealing current for carrier systems. In fact, when I started at the phone company, it was all analog carrier. And the sealing current that they ran on the analog carrier was substantial. How do I know? I was unlucky enough to touch it once. You could taste the fillings in your teeth. So they deliberately ran a high amount of DC current to keep splices clean, to keep them sealed up. Well, plain old dial tone had the same effect every time you went off hook. Well, now no one's going off hook anymore. No one's going off hook anymore, right? So those pairs are starting to seal up. Where they started to seal up previously, they're now going open. All right. Now, I don't know if you use this technique or not. If you do, if you don't, please do. When should I use it, Jeff? Wait until the numbers drop bad, like I got here, the 72 to a 40. Why should I wait that long? Because I know you will fix it. You'll find it. You will have to be blind not to find it. You'll find it. You will fix it. And then you will have proven the worth of the test. We'll never have to talk about it again. I'll chase them if they drop 6 dB. But I want to prove it to you first, because you don't know me from Adam, right? Now, over the years, I've had guys sit, more experienced guys, they sit and they listen, and they'll politely say, well, I see what you're doing, but I just do it different. I say, well, yeah, what do you do? And they say, well, I use my own meter. Old guy taught me this a long time ago. He said, shorten ground the pair like you did, but then just take your ohm meter and read how many ohms you got on that wire to ground and compare it to how much you got on that wire to ground, right? I'm doing the same thing you are. I say, well, no, you're not, for three reasons. Number one, you can certainly read resistance in this fashion. It's called a grounded Varley test. So you're reading the amount of ohms in this wire to compare it to that wire, and there's a spec, right? But when you do it with an ohm meter, your return path is through the dirt. Now, that's usually not good, because what it does is it drives your ohm meter into the three-digit range. Now, it's virtually impossible to do this with an analog meter. obviously, you're looking for single digit differences. So you almost need the digital meter to do this. But when your return path is through the dirt, you get driven into the three digit range. The problem is that third significant digit will go up and down naturally. So you don't know if you're looking at trouble or if you're just looking at a little noise on the cable. You don't know. Huh? That's reason number one. Reason number two, let's say you do it this way. The ground was perfect, and by golly, you did see 11 ohms more on one side than you did on the other. Except the 11 ohms is distributed, meaning I pick up an ohm here, that splice. Next splice, I got a half an ohm. Next one, a three quarters of an ohm. You follow me? Good luck trying to find that with your ohm meter. And reason number three, what is inside of an ohm meter? How does it work? I already told you that, right? A DC battery. When you put DC battery on something that is shorted together and has a path to ground, it turns into DC current. That is the absolutely last thing you want to apply and use this test is DC current, because it has a ceiling effect. So three reasons why it's not the same thing. All right. I'll show you one more thing. This is controversial. It should get me in trouble. It's the only thing I have to look forward to nowadays is getting myself in trouble. So another one to use for longitudinal mounts is the one I'm going to show you here. Now, this is just two random. It could be a cross box and a customer. You know, it's just two pedestals here and cable pair in the middle. Now, I've been doing class like this for longer than I care to remember, but I've met some just great people over the years. I mean, I have met telephone guys that and gals that I couldn't have carried water to in my best day. I mean, that's one of the cool things about traveling is you get to see people do all sorts of different things, right? And you watch somebody do something that you've done 1,000 times before, but he's got a better way of doing it. And you say to yourself, damn, why didn't I think of that? You know? So that's happened to me a lot. So I'm very, very humbled that anybody would pick up the phone and call me. And sometimes they do. And they'll say, you know, Jeff, I've got a problem with this cable pair, and I'd kind of like to talk to you about it. And, okay, what do you got? Well, I don't know. We might have one of them noise things or something. How's the cable pair look? You know, this is me talking to the guy, right? Oh, cable pair looks great. There's no cross battery, 999s for resistance. There's no opens. Can't see anything with a TDR, right? How's the longitudinal balance or the stress? Either one, whatever makes more sense to you. Here's the answer. Well, it ain't perfect, but they're all that way out here. Huh? I've heard that a million times. So what he's saying is, in this cable, instead of getting 60s, he's getting this. They're all that way out here, right? Everything he measures. Well, I'm a telephone guy too, and telephone guys love to tease, right? So the first thing I say is, how in the hell can you tell me they're all that way out here until you make one more measurement? You don't know if that 54 is coming from one spot or if they're all that way out here, all right? Now, let me preface or add on quickly here. When I first got turned on to shooting balance trouble, all right, I became a religious zealot. I mean, by golly, it had to be 60 dB. And if it wasn't 60 dB, there's trouble on it. I just went overboard. I had that type of personality. I'd run up and down cable pairs that dead 55 or 53, 54. And you know what I found? An unsettlingly amount of the time, I would get somewhere in that cable and I would have a 53 going north and a 53 going south. Yeah? Kind of took the wind out of my sails. So this guy does exactly what I tell him. He goes out and makes a measurement, and this is what he finds. He's got a 53 going north. He's got a 53 going south. By God, they are all that way out here. There's a surefire fix for this. I've never seen it fail to not work. If you can go somewhere along that cable pair where you're showing the same marginal balance in both directions, open that cable pair up and splice tip to ring and ring to tip. I have seen one flop take a 53 and turn it to a 75. I have presented this in front of 300 national staff engineering people for one phone company, all in the conference room. I presented that you could have heard a pin drop. You could have heard a pin drop. There was a lot of murmuring. You know, started murmuring. Well, you're split. I'm not splitting anything. I'm splicing tip to ring and ring to tip. I'm not splitting anything. Well, where'd you come up with that? I've never heard it. I didn't come up with it. You did. This is an old Bell system thing. Remember, I said, I've never come up with an original idea in my life. This is an old Bell system thing. Now, the equivalent of this is something called tramping. Now, they use that on iron wire. No, I'm not old enough to have worked on an iron wire, but as a young kid, I took a hell of a lot of it down. 10-party iron wire leads had two iron wires, right? One ran at the top of the pole, one halfway down, or thereabouts. But they could only run that way for so long, and then the one at the top had to come down, and the one that was down had to go up to the top. That was called tramping. And if you didn't do that, get at the end of that iron wire lead, and it'd be roaring so loud you couldn't use it. This is the same exact equivalent thing. By having a 53 going north and a 53 going south, that tells you there is no one spot to improve balance. That balance is degrading over the length of the pair. So by me flopping the conductors like that, what have I done? I've made them look more alike. Now, people have heartburn with this. A special service guys really freak out. I don't know why. Well, I got voltage on the pair and I need... You got a voltmeter, don't you? Figure out what conductor's got the voltage on it, lay it down. What's the big deal? There is no big deal. Now, if your boss comes back to you and says, hey, I don't care what that clown from Michigan says, you're not going to do that in my cable. Well, then, you know, you don't see my name on your paycheck and do what you're told. But please keep it in context if you repeat it. This is a cable pair where there's no physical faults. TDR looks, everything looks good, except balance, the most important measurement, right? And it's marginal. I read this out of an old Bell system book, and I tried it on an old lady's line that was out in the country. And I was nervous as you know what in church. I was nervous. Ah, man, I don't know if this is the right thing to do. And, you know, every one of us had been on this old lady's, out to this old lady's house. Felt sorry for her. She lived all by herself. Hell of a hum on her line. Just a hellacious hum. I thought, how in the world am I going to keep track of this? I'm nervous, right? I don't know if I probably shouldn't even be doing it. I thought, I know what I'll do. I'll do it at every load point. Well, she had like 8 load points. It was a long cable pair. See, 8 damn times. I flopped them. I said, I'll remember because we're at the load points, right? I did the last one, went out to her house, and I thought I cut her pair or something. Because the moment I clipped down with the butt set, it was like a well. It was like a church quiet. It was so quiet. It was unbelievable. Right? Because I made one wire look like the other wire. Now, I probably did it 7 more times than I needed to. Back then, I didn't know any better. So lots of different ways to look at this, folks. You can look at it as, well, I ain't doing that. Or you can look at it and say, gosh, who do we know that's got all the money to replace all the bad sections they have tomorrow? If you know somebody that has that much money, give me their name. I want to put my application in because I don't know anybody. So we're all facing the same issue, right? Marginal cable that we've got to squeeze some more life by. Excellent way to squeeze the life out of the cable. Is this being used? Yep, it's being used all over the place. Probably one of the most successful ones, Third Line Manager, big phone company, had a section of cable that special service wanted to put HDSL on, and they had a real tight tolerance. If your cable didn't hit 60 dB of balance, specials wouldn't take it. Well, that poor guy was friends with a guy that I was working with on another project, and he was telling me this over dinner, and he said, boy, he's pulling his hair out, because if he places that cable, it's going to blow his budget for the year. And so I listened to the whole story. I said, you know, just for the hell of it, have one of his guys go out there about halfway and flop it. Well, he did. And it took the 53 and turned it to 75. Special service was happy, and this guy was ecstatic, right? So this stuff works. It's not magic. It's not simple. It's just common sense. It really is. So underneath that, we've got, we'll go take a look at the, we're starting to wind down here, folks. I'm sorry to have to talk for 2 hours straight, but it's just not a real easy thing to break up these recorded WebExes. But below longitudinal balance, we have the traditional power influence noise balance. So if you can still measure the ambient or what's out there naturally, right, this way. Now, as I travel around the country, I find everybody still has trouble with power influence. I thought it was something that was going to go away. I find out that it hasn't gone away at all, right? So let's end by this. I'll give you four things about power influence that I wish somebody would have given me when I started working on this stuff, because it would have saved me a lot of time and, in one case, a lot of physical work. So if you're the unlucky person that your boss taps on the shoulder and says, hey, Charlie, I'm sick and tired of hearing about this power influence stuff out on Bishop Road, get your butt out there today and fix it. Well, in my day, to make a power influence reading, you dial into the central office quiet termination, right? Now, quiet termination is not drop battery. Drop battery is you pulling the module. A quiet termination is an own special little number in the CO that sets the CO up just like it's set up when somebody's talking on it, except there's nobody there, right? Hence the word quiet. Well, nowadays you can't dial up on people's lines. If they hear you dialing on the phone, they freak out. So you're forced to make your power influence measurements on non-working cable. Well, the thing to remember on non-working cable is you got to make it look like it's working. And the way you do that is short one end to ground. Now it looks like the CO is hooked to it. And any power influence values that you record will be valid. If you fail to short one end to ground, it doesn't matter which end, by the way, any power influence values you read or record will be completely invalid. You're wasting your time. Number two, the industry has something called a 95% rule. This isn't Jeff's rule or JDSU or Dynatel. This is coming from guys that do this for a living. And the 95% rule is pretty easy to understand. If you're looking at that power influence minus noise equation on your ONX right now, notice that power influence and noise are both measured on a scale there. See the scale DBRNC. Remember that. The 95% rule says if measured power influence is greater than 95 DBRNC, 95% of the time you need help from the local power company to get it to come down. The easy way to think about this, it's like stuffing 10 pounds of you-know-what in a 5-pound bag. Ain't gonna fit, right? Meaning they can whack our stuff so bad that we can run and we can do all this bonding and grounding, all this happy stuff, and we'll never get it to come down without their help. Number three, when you start thinking about power influence and the power company in general, you're human, you can't help it. Your eyes are attracted to what I call big power line stuff. 250-foot steel towers, 345,000 volts running down them. the substation that's 2 acres in size, right? I bet you that's, no, it's not. Those steel towers and substations are the power company's bank account. They watch that stuff like you and I watch our wallets. The chances of that big power line stuff being the source of your problem is just about zero. Fourth, the one that's most near and dear to my heart because it would have saved me the most physical labor. Technicians confuse high AC voltage readings, read with a voltmeter, with power influence. If you have high AC voltage, say, hey, you got power? Yeah, I do. What do you got? Well, out here in Brownwell, we got 50 pair of cable. We got 50 volts AC on everything. High AC voltage read with a voltmeter cannot be fixed by bonding and grounding cable. You're wasting your time. It's physically impossible. Techs are surprised to find out you can have moderate levels of power influence, in other words, not that much, and have 30 to 40 volts AC on the line. The flip is true. You can have 100 dBRNC of power influence and have 4 volts AC on the line. They are related, but they're like third cousins twice removed. They're not the same thing. Now, we always use a shotgun approach, right? Well, you got AC problem, bond and ground, bond and ground. Well, bond and grounding is great for safety. Don't get me wrong. It's essential. But for AC voltage induced from the power company, high levels of AC voltage, read with a voltmeter, cannot be fixed by bonding and grounding. So your boss tells you to go get that 50 volts off the cable on Brown Road by bonding and grounding, tell him to send you home with pay that day because you're not going to accomplish a darn thing. All right, we'll bounce back out here to the ONX. So under options for the regular power influence, you always want to use the IEEE 743, the C message filter. We gave you some other options there. It's primarily for different countries, so use the C message for power influence. Let's see. We didn't talk about milliamp current flow. We'll maybe talk about that just for a second. Milliamp current flow used to be something that we had to check in every case of trouble that we went to. These are dial tone lines. So you walk up to a dial tone phone, you know you got 52 volts battery there, right? You go off hook with the phone, you put a short on the line. You short a DC battery, current flows. It's back to that ohmmeter thing. It's the current flow that the central office sees that says, hey, this person needs dial tone. Do you suppose the central office needs to see a certain amount of current flowing before you give you dial tone? The answer, of course, is yes. That's why years ago we had to make the measurement. So as the loops get shorter and shorter and shorter, probably the need for this is dropping rapidly. So just to kind of give you an explanation of why it's there. And then a little coil of wire, looks like a spring. That's our load coil test. So we'll test up to 5 with a plus or minus accuracy of 1. Everybody in the business got the same spec. We'll count the loads numerically. And with that green line, we'll show you the pattern of reflections. So I noticed we had a lot of Frontier folk on here, a lot of CenturyLink folk. You probably still have areas where you got load coils. This is a great thing to look at on loaded cable pairs because it actually gives you the equivalent of what's called a level tracer, which is a very expensive device that we had years ago. It did the same thing. You can look at the pattern of reflections and tell whether you got a loading issue just by what that green line looks like. So, All right. Well, I am going to go back out to the main menu here, folks, and pretty much tell you that's all I had for you today.